Welcome to Lingthusiasm, a podcast that's enthusiastic about linguistics. I'm Lauren Gawne.
And I'm Gretchen McCulloch. And today, we're getting enthusiastic about imperatives. But first, we're going to do a Lingthusiasm live show, a virtual live show in late April brought to you on an internet near you for everybody who's a patron of Lingthusiasm, which there is still time to become. So keep an eye out in late April 2021. We'll be announcing the dates on social media and the website a little bit closer to the time.
This live show is our current Patreon goal. All tickets will be for patrons, so that is available at lingthusiasm.com/Patreon. If you're listening to this in the future from beyond April 2021, patrons will also be able to listen to the recording of that live show event as a bonus episode, along with over 50 other bonus episodes.
The Lingthusiasm live show is also part of Lingfest, which is a bunch of other fun linguistics events that are happening in late April. Stay tuned to our website for more information about that. And also in late April, we're doing a virtual conference for linguistics communicators called LingCom. So that's people who make linguistics communication materials online, sort of modeled after SciComm for science communicators. And this is going to be happening online, and you can find more details about LingCom on the website lingcom.org. That's com with two M's.
Our most recent Patreon bonus episode was an Ask Us Anything episode in celebration of our 100th overall episode. It is our 48th bonus, and along with our over 50 main episodes, it means there is twice as much Lingthusiasm if you've worked your way through all the main episodes. They are all available at lingthusiasm.com/Patreon.
Thanks for asking us such great questions on the Lingthusiasm Patron Discord, and go hang on the Discord if you haven't yet. It's fun. The episode.
Go on.
Be interesting.
Do linguistics.
Stay enthusiastic.
All of these sentences are giving some kind of command.
These are all what's known grammatically as imperatives. And they have the function of giving commands, but they also have the imperative, which is this particular grammatical thing where in English, an imperative, they begin with the bare form of the verb, like start and go and be and do and stay. And that's the particular grammatical concept that we want to talk about today.
The function of giving a command means that now, Gretchen, I expect you for the next half hour to be very interesting and very linguistic. If you're going to obey the command that's been given.
No, I was telling you to be interesting, Lord.
Oh, okay. Well, now we're in trouble. It is possible to do things that have the function of giving some kind of command that's not an imperative, that doesn't have the grammar of an imperative structure. Mm-hmm. So I order you to be interesting is not actually a imperative.
It is a command, but it is not an imperative. And sometimes, you know, you have this sort of, I want to say this very imperial, you know, kind of ancient Rome, the imperator, the emperor saying, you know, take this man away as sort of a command thing. But you can also use imperatives, the form of the imperative, to do things that are very polite. So you can say something like, come in, sit down, make yourself at home. And all of these are also imperatives, but they're polite imperatives.
Yeah, I hope people don't think we're being imperious when we use the imperative to tell them to stay enthusiastic at the end of an episode.
Secretly, this episode, we've been building up to it since the very first one.
Emperor and imperative are related etymologically, I assume?
Yeah, the emperor is somebody who has the authority to give commands, and it's definitely sort of the core function of the imperative is that sort of commanding function. But when I think of imperatives, I think about a young adult novel that came out in 1997 called Ella Enchanted.
Did this also become, I remember, a movie?
No, don't talk to me about the movie. The movie is bad.
Okay. Well, I haven't seen the film, so that's fine. We can just talk about the book, which I also have not read. So enlighten us about Ella Enchanted.
So Ella Enchanted is one of those fairy tale retellings. And in this particular context, the main character has a blessing slash curse put on her by a fairy at her birth, where she has to be obedient.
Oh, is this one of those blessings that inadvertently become a curse?
Yeah. And so the fairy is like, I'm going to give you this blessing. You know, Ella will always be obedient. Now stop crying, child. And the baby has to stop crying because she's been given this command to stop crying.
Very useful.
I mean, like, who amongst us would not find this useful. But unfortunately, she grows up and, you know, if people give her command even inadvertently, she has to obey it. But what's interesting from the grammatical perspective, and I feel like why I always felt like I had a very solid grasp on what an imperative is, is because she only has to obey things when they're imperative commands and not when they're more indirect commands. So if somebody says, like, stand up, sit down, she has to do it.
Right.
But if someone says, I wish you would stand up, or why don't you sit down, she doesn't have to do it at that point.
Oh my gosh, she's a walking grammaticality test. She'll
right?
tell you if something is grammatically an imperative. This is fabulous.
Right.
It would be amazing to have someone like this while you're trying to figure out the grammar of an imperative.
Well, because then you could try it in different languages.
Mm-hmm.
Every time I see a stop sign, I'm like, Ella would just be stuck here. Like, she'd just be stuck here until someone told her to go again.
I assume it's like a pre-technology world. Because
yeah, you know, it's like a fairy tale world with horses and stuff. So she didn't have any stop signs.
Thank goodness she doesn't live on the internet, because the amount of like, subscribe, click here, you would be ruined.
Right, like every time she got told to like and subscribe, she'd have to do it. Yeah, so, it, you know, it's a fairy tale world, so she only has, like, the usual problems
with
imperatives. But it really, you know, if you ever want a book to just, like, tell you which things are imperatives for, like, 286 pages of a charming young adult fantasy novel, I would recommend it.
I feel like if you have very small children in your life, you're also quite sensitive to imperatives and using them. There's a lot of having to be very direct at children. Even if you have a habit of maybe doing things more politely and indirectly while talking to adults, you just have to tell children to do and to not do things quite a lot. And so if you have small children or maybe like cheeky pets in your life.
Pets. No, get off that. Don't run into traffic.
Sit perfectly.
Sit, efficient. Stay. Eat your breakfast.
Yeah, I was going to say, I can't tell if you're giving that example to a child or to a pet, but honestly, pretty much the
Does
same.
Does it matter? Yeah.
So if you have small people in your life, you're probably quite sensitive to imperatives.
Meanwhile, I'm just sitting here with my tomato plants being like, grow, grow. Yeah, and that's one of the things that's really interesting about, I mean, partially in Ella Enchanted. Like, at one point she gets a letter from her father, and then she's like, wait, I'm going to make this other person read it and summarize it to me, because if there are commands in it, then she could summarize what they are in ways that aren't actually commands. In another context, she's interacting with a character who she doesn't really like, but because that character is only saying, you know, like, I wish you would do this, or why can't you stop doing that, she doesn't actually have to obey that person because that character is still trying to be polite. And so imperatives have this sort of interesting interaction with politeness and with, like, how we relate to each other as people.
Hmm.
You know, who is it okay to give a direct imperative to, and, like, what level of politeness does that have?
Yeah, and it seems like giving direct imperatives to kids is something that occurs across a lot of different cultures. We don't have the data to say with confidence that it happens across all languages. And in some languages, it's weirder to give direct imperatives to people who you're not familiar with. Maybe if you're more familiar with someone, so you might give more direct imperatives to someone you live with and spend a lot of time with. It really can vary across cultures and across individual contexts. But one particular example I like is Sarah Chishelsky's work on the acquisition of Sherpa by children. So Sherpa is a Tibeto-Burman language. It's in the same family of languages I work with. And in Sarah's work, there's a great 3-minute thesis video summarizing it. What she found was that parents give a particular type of direct imperative to small children. And as the children grow older, they give those imperatives less. You know, children stop doing particularly foolhardy things and they start to become more socialized into behaving in a socially appropriate way. But in her data, she found that as those children got older, they were given fewer imperatives. But if they were talking to younger children, they would give them in the way that the adults do. And so you could see them getting socialized into this process of, if I'm talking to someone younger than me and someone who's very young, I have to give them lots of direct imperative commands.
I feel like I remember something about children learning a lot of imperatives very early in Mayan languages as well.
Hmm.
I'm not sure. I think it's, I'm trying to find the paper. And of course, I can't find it again. But I remember reading a paper in grad school about Mayan children learning a lot of imperatives. I think it was K'iche, maybe, or some combination of K'iche, Yucatec, and possibly Mam. And these are languages that do a fair number of things with the verbs, but the imperatives tend to be morphologically very short and very simple and not have a lot of prefixes and suffixes. And so they also sort of make really good words for children to start learning more complicated verbal structures with.
Right. And so they learn these structures, but they also learn who it's socially appropriate to use them with. I mean, it's one of those things I have no real depth of knowledge about child language acquisition, but I'm always amazed by, like, children are given so many imperatives, but they still manage to use verbs and acquire verbs in all their other forms, even though for some cases, and I know in Sarah's work, like, the number of verbs in the imperative form that children are exposed to is, like, multiple times more than some other grammatical structures. But we manage to all grow up using more than just imperative forms of verbs.
Well, and kids also sort of overhear speech of adults between each other, even if they're not addressed like that themselves.
Yeah, absolutely.
So, you know, you have a variety of things that you're exposed to. But yeah, like, the imperative is this sort of interesting, you know, it's like how linguists often observe that words that are for, like, close family members mm-hmm. have certain sounds that tend to be cross-linguistically easier. You know, mama, baba, dada, nana, tata, papa. Like, there's a sort of small set of syllables that are pretty easy for kids, and often the names for close family members are from some subset of those syllables. And they're not necessarily exactly the same from language to language, but they're a bit more similar than you'd expect coincidentally. And I think that, you know, imperatives often being a little bit easier, a little bit shorter, having a little bit less complex verbal morphology on them. I don't know if someone has done that official typological study, but it seems like there's a sort of general trend in that direction.
Which you need when someone is dangerously going in the wrong direction and you need to tell them to stop, or someone is just being a little bit too hectic and you need to tell them to sit.
Like, you can imagine early humans, like a kid putting their hand into fire or something, and you have to be like, no, stop! Like, kids can try to do very dangerous things in lots of contexts, and it's useful to have language that's accessible to tell them how to not do that.
Yeah. Those short forms, we often talk about them as being bare because they don't have any extra morphemes that we stick on. Some languages do have a specific grammatical suffix that they'll stick on for an imperative. In Yolmo and other Tibetan languages, the kind of politer form of the imperative has the suffix tong or dong. There are some that just a bare if you're being very direct at someone.
Yeah, and English for the most part has a bare imperative as well. So you have, you know, sit, stand, and it's not like sitting or stand, stance, or, you know, walked,
yeah.
Which would be adding some sort of morpheme on there. I guess in principle you could add a prefix on there. I'm not aware of a language that does, but probably is one somewhere.
Yeah, it's always dangerous to say languages don't do something because there'll be some awesome language somewhere that does the thing.
There's probably somewhere that do a prefix. I wouldn't put money on that not happening. But yeah, often imperatives are a bit on the short side, especially ones that are informal or singular, like the kind you would use with a child, compared to like polite imperatives. Oh, you can put lots of morphology on to be polite.
Yeah, so there's the suffix in Yolmo, and then there's a whole different form if you're being very polite in the honorific register. We've talked about honorifics in a bonus episode before, and I've talked about that vocabulary there. So again, that's that thing about giving a command is not necessarily impolite. You just have to use the correct honorific verb form to be polite when you're asking a visiting guru to kind of come with you or to please sit down. There's a way to do that politely.
Yeah. I think encountered imperative, at least as a term, when I was studying Latin, and they have a singular and a plural imperative. So if you're giving command to one person, or if you're giving a command to multiple people, which, you know, many languages do something like this. And the singular imperative is just the sort of bare root of the verb with the theme vowel. So you have something like veni, which means come, singular, and then venite is come, plural, all of you come.
Good for specific command giving.
Yeah, and so there's this extra morpheme on the plural form, but the singular one, which is your sort of like, you know, am I giving this command to a child, is a sort of very simple form.
I did say Yolmo had that suffix, but there are a couple of verbs where instead of using a suffix for the regular everyday imperative, there's just a completely different word.
Mm.
And the most common one is Yolmo has the word sa for eat. And if it was just a regular imperative based on the model of almost every other verb, it would be sadong. But for this verb specifically, you have a completely different form of the word. You just say saw.
Hmm. And there's no dong at all.
There's no dong at all there. So there's no suffix there. It's just a very short form. It's a word I heard a lot people asking me to eat as a guest. So it's one I'm very familiar with.
And yeah, this actually happens in a variety of kinds of contexts where, you know, you'd expect one specific thing with, you know, the prefixes and suffixes, and then you get a different form of the root entirely. So in French, for example, most of the imperatives kind of do a very similar thing. You have parler is to talk, and parler is also the imperative and the plural imperative. But then for a few words, and one of them is be, you have, you know, je suis tu es. So you are a, but the imperative, like be quiet, which you know, say to a child, perhaps, is sois tranquille. Literally be tranquil, I guess, but the it's used for be quiet. Or soyez, if it's plural, like children, soyez tranquille, like all of you be quiet. And English actually also kind of does this.
Right.
And this is kind of the one, like, maybe true imperative that you can sort of test, like, is this verb being imperative right now?
You told me this the other day, and I was racking my brains for ages trying to think about something where it changes.
Have you figured it out
yet? I've not figured it out, but now you've given me that example. I bet it's something to do with the is be copula.
It is
the is. Because that verb is a mess in English.
Yeah, it is be. So, be is just one of those really neat verbs because it's like historically three different verbs, like all with their different forms glommed onto each other. You have the like the is are one, and you have the wesan with was and were, and then you also have be and being and been, and those are all from like three different roots that got like glommed together to make one mega verb.
Yay language.
And this is a process that actually happens like fairly often in languages just for a small handful of very, very common words. So
yes.
Be or have or maybe something like eat, like very, very common words. Sometimes they get really irregular, really sort of, you know, they get made out of combinations of several different verbs. And because they're so common, people can just remember this. Whereas if it's a really rare verb that maybe you don't encounter until you're a bit older or you don't encounter very often, it'd be hard to remember like, oh, this verb like has completely different letters in it.
It would be very weird for English to have a completely different form of the word to crochet for an imperative.
Right.
Because
right.
Most people don't talk about crocheting a lot. And if you do, you rarely tell people that they have to as a command. So when you have this pattern that fits for every verb except maybe one or two for the imperative or for other things as well, English is great with this kind of thing in like tense when you have I go, I went. Went
yeah.
is absolutely a completely different word to go, but we use it in the past. This happens often enough in English that when we have these forms that don't fit the pattern, we call it a suppletive form.
Yeah, and sometimes the imperative is where a suppletive shows up. Sometimes it's also a past or something else you could do with things. But yeah, so sometimes you get a suppletive imperative, which kind of defies the point about maybe them being easy for children to learn. but they are super common.
You tend to hear suppletive forms with lots of frequency. That's how they manage to stick around.
And sometimes you also get a negative imperative.
Yes. As with the fact that, you know, some languages use particular morphemes and some languages don't use any morphemes, which is a nice throwback to our zero morphemes in the Nothing Means Something episode, if you remember that sometimes the absence of something is still functional. There's a whole range of different ways that negating can interact with imperatives. But the thing I find most charming about the relationship between negating and imperatives is that a negative imperative as a category can sometimes be called a prohibitive. Which oh. is just one of those like, oh yeah, that does exactly what that label says.
Yeah, so the imperative is you command someone to do something, the prohibitive is you prohibit them from doing something, which kind yeah. of makes sense. I have definitely just encountered the terminology negative imperative. I hadn't encountered prohibitive. I think, you know, maybe a little bit in the literature or until you mentioned it. I was like, oh yeah, I guess you could call it that. I don't know if I would though.
I think it's the kind of thing where if your language does something interesting around negative imperatives, you're more likely to come up with the name prohibitive. Whereas, so for example, in Yolmo, you don't use that imperative suffix with the negative.
Ah.
You just use the negative and the verb. And so because it acts a bit differently to the imperative, I'm more likely to think of it as a prohibitive because it's a slightly different structure. But I think this comes back to a larger conversation about whether you kind of lump certain phenomena together because they're all similar enough in the languages that you encounter, or if you split them up because they behave very differently.
Yeah, I think I'm maybe more of a lumper than a splitter, but, you know, it depends a lot on the context because what sort of thing you're exposed to can sort of lead you more into lumperish or splitterish directions for particular things.
Yeah.
You know, some languages just throw in a negator. Some languages, the negation bit for imperatives is a different negative morpheme than the negative morpheme in other contexts. Some languages, you use a different form of the verb. When I was learning a lot of Romance languages, the thing that we always used to really just kind of grind my gears and show my lumperish tendencies was they'd be like, okay, you know, here are all the different ways of doing the imperative. And there'd be like two that would sort of correspond to the Latin one of like the singular and the plural one. And then there'd be like the polite one, and there'd be like the we form for like let's this, and there'd be like the negative ones. And those would all be like borrowed from the subjunctive.
Which is an entirely different category with an entirely different set of functions, but kind of,
yeah,
borrowable.
We're not going to get into the subjunctive right now because the subjunctive is a whole other episode someday. But I'd be like, these forms are not some sort of like weird, surprising thing you actually have to memorize like 17 different things. What it is look over here in this table on page 56 and just borrow the ones from the table on page 56. You only have to memorize like one bit of information, which is the go to page 56 for this form. You don't have to just suddenly memorize this whole other table as if it's some sort of surprising thing that's unconnected. It's really just borrowing from a different part of the paradigm.
And yeah, sometimes imperatives do share features or functions with other categories, which is a thing that crops up a lot in different categories of grammar. It's part of the fun of human languages and how they all evolve in different directions and borrow things from themselves and copy across from different parts.
Yeah, and it's interesting to think, okay, you know, like, what was the historical version of this? What was the version of this language early on when they were like, oh, we don't quite have an imperative for this particular context. Where else can we get something from the set of verbs that we do have, or some of the set of things that we're used to doing with verbs?
Another thing that makes imperatives particularly interesting to try and elicit from someone, if you're doing elicitation to figure out the grammar of a language as a linguist, or if you just want to learn a language through kind of politely interrogating native speakers, is that it's actually really difficult to ask someone to tell you how that they should tell you to do something. It's a socially complicated little situation.
Yeah, because if you say something like, you know, tell me that I should sit down, they'd be like, okay, you should sit down. And you're like, no, wait, that's not an imperative. That's just, yeah, that's a different statement, you know.
Asking someone to tell you to do something directly when they clearly don't, like, they don't actually want you to eat. So it feels weird and unnatural to be like, eat.
Yeah, and you know, some people find it more fun to join that sort of play space about language. Like, let's imagine that we have a dog and we're trying to get the dog to eat. Or let's imagine we're trying to tell a child to eat or something like that. But yeah, it's sort of figuring out, okay, like, what is the exact context that can create the scenario in which it would be said, even though it's said a lot.
Yeah, and that's not even taking into account that you might be working with someone in a culture where it is just so rude to give someone a direct command, and that, like, you need to observe them hanging out with a child or a pet or if a person they're really close to get actual uses of the imperative, because you're some outsider to whom it would be incredibly rude to do that.
Yeah, and some places you can use imperatives politely as well, but there's often this sort of additional kind of social context. And I think that there's also, you know, we were talking about earlier about, like, well, you have this polite imperative, or you have this plural imperative, or this honorific imperative. And in a lot of the European languages that have these polite second person pronouns, you know, vous or si or usted or something like that, they also kind of like figured out some sort of like imperative there, which is borrowed from some other bit of the verbal thing there, because, like, oh, we need an imperative, but this was actually originally a third person or a plural or something, and you have to kind of grab it from somewhere else. And so imperatives kind of start you into, okay, well, what do people do in this language, in this particular culture, when they're addressing somebody? What are the ways you address somebody? What are the ways you don't address somebody? Which things are polite? Which things are impolite? And what are all the sorts of like things you can do? There's this word in French that I don't actually know what it means so much as I know how it's used. which is just like the word you add to something to make it a polite imperative.
Excellent.
And it's veiller. It's got a lot of L's in it. That's what French says. And it's like, so you'll see it on a lot of official signage. I don't know if I've ever heard someone say it out loud, but it's on so much signage. And so you'd have like, you know, veiller, sit down when the train is in motion or something like this.
It's where you'd use please in a polite English imperative.
But it's not please because you can put s'il vous plaît in there as well, which is please.
Right.
It's just like the polite verb that you use for the polite things. And I'm sure it has a literal meaning, but that literal meaning is not as relevant as the fact that it's the polite verb you use for the polite things.
The social function of giving a command is also why imperatives are discussed as a thing where you direct it towards someone else who's also there. So a second person, you do this. Because in order for a command to be effective, it has to be a person delivering it to another person.
Yeah, and it sort of depends on how lumper and splittery you want to get if you want to talk about, like, first-person plural imperatives. If you want to talk about something like let's as an imperative or, you know, using other words like hortative, it sort of depends on what the grammar of a particular language is doing, whether it makes sense to group it with the imperatives or not. But sometimes, like, let's go or, like, let him go, like, let them eat cake, sometimes those are sort of treated with the imperatives and sometimes they're not.
Yeah.
But there's also, there's sort of a core set of imperatives of like, okay, well, you know, what do you do if you're addressing one person, maybe a few people? And then there's all of the sort of ancillary stuff around imperatives, which is still just not that big of a space.
Yeah.
And I think it's one of those things where, you know, there's something about how humans organize their societies and their culture and their notions of selfhood and...
And how human brains are constructed.
How human brains are constructed... It's kind of like how, you know, human societies have words for like day and night cycles because we live on a planet that has a certain kind of day and night cycle that's like really salient to everybody who's here. And that doesn't mean in theory you couldn't have humans who lived on a different sort of planet that had vastly different day and night cycles that could have words for those sorts of things.
This is why I love speculative science fiction, because you get to build worlds where if you had people who could melt their consciousnesses together, then the distinction between giving a command as an imperative to a second person kind of becomes less meaningful if you're all the one consciousness.
Yeah, if you had, you know, like neural links or, you know, or a society with magic or something where like certain imperatives come with the force of commands where they're magically enforced and certain of them are suggestions, maybe that ends up sort of showing up in the grammar at some point. Or if you had... I don't know, like swarm consciousnesses or something, or diffused consciousnesses, maybe the first and second persons would work really differently because your notion of consciousness would be different.
If you had multiple consciousnesses within one body, would you use a third person imperative to talk to yourself?
I think there are people who have distributed consciousness or multiple consciousness, and they do sort of various kinds of things, sometimes like a we and sometimes addressing other people.
Yeah, there's so much scope for possibility, and humans occupy a tiny piece of that real estate, usually.
Yeah, like there's in Embassy Town by China Melville, there's this thing where you have like two brains that are sort of occupying, like they have to say all of the words together at the same time.
Ah, yeah. It's been a long time since I've read that book, and it is so full of fantasticness that I can't even remember how those multiple brain persons exist.
Yeah, I don't... It's been a long time since I read this book as well. I did not reread it like Ella Enchanted, but I remember that in the text, the words that they say simultaneously are written above and below like a long line.
Right.
Like an M dash or a long M dash. Yeah. And the words are written above and below and you have sort of two mouths, but one consciousness. And it's kind of a surface level treatment there because it's not asking the question of like, what would that mean for first persons and second persons and third persons? It's just sort of like they say all of the words all at once, even if it's just a noun.
Going to write a grant application to do field work with fictional aliens in a sci-fi fictional world.
I just think this space is really underdeveloped and some people should be working on it.
There's so much possibility for what an imperative could do in other consciousnesses, but in the human languages that we know about and have been discussed in general, it's doing something with the verb. That's where it tends to hang out. That's what we've been discussing so far. As always, I'm sure there are many caveats and complications, but it's doing something to the verb that's different from, say, something like tense, which is looking at time and where in time the verb is situated. So it's turning something that's an action into a command.
Yeah, and there's a distinction. I think the easiest one to notice is the distinction between something like I see, I look, I sit, I go, versus see, look, sit, go, where one of them is sort of describing something that's going on, and the other one is giving a command, which can have all of the functions of polite command or impolite command, that sort of range. And it, yeah, it does sort of change the vibe of the verb. And the Romans, who did a lot of the sort of descriptive grammatical tradition that we've inherited in the European language space, called this the mood of the verb, rather than, I think we should maybe rename it the vibe of the verb.
Yeah.
Because it seems very intuitive to me.
Yeah.
And mood in this context is not like, is the verb happy or sad? It's just a vowel shift from mode. So, like, what mode is this verb in? It's in the command mode, it's in the, you know, declarative mode, it's like describing things mode, or it's kind of like, you know, like, set your gears to start or to reverse or to...
Yeah, and look, I'm not going to lie. I think when these labels got added and kind of about 500 years ago, they became really consistent with kind of grammar teaching. When they chose this word, I'm pretty sure they chose it for a really similar reason that you chose vibe. Like, mode is just this general word. It's still a pretty general word. You know, we use it for fashion or, as you said, like a mode of a machine.
Like your mode of transportation.
It's just one of these wonderfully convenient labels that you don't have to interrogate too deeply.
Yeah, mode sort of seems to apply that you can have a given verb and it can sometimes be in this mode and sometimes be in that mode, whereas class sort of implies you have, you know, some verbs are in this class and some verbs are in that class and they don't sort of correspond, but they're all just sort of generic categorization words and they kind of just picked one.
Yeah.
Like, as far as I can tell, they kind of just picked one and then that became the name for this distinction that they were trying to talk about of, you know, is the verb like this or is the verb like that? Well, that's its mode. And then we had an unfortunate vowel shift and it seems like it corresponds to a mood like happy or sad. But mode is sort of the more intuitive way of thinking about what the difference is between these categories.
And people will sometimes use mood and they'll sometimes use mode and talk about modality. If you see something that's talking about modality in linguistics, it's generally talking about, well, is it just a declarative sentence explaining how the world works or is it in one of these other modes like the imperative? And there are a whole bunch of others in this category.
Well, and sometimes modality is also used for, you know, modals, which, you know, like can and must and should and stuff like that.
Oh, we should talk about modal verbs.
Yeah, we should do a whole episode about modals.
With evidentiality, which is something we've done a whole episode on, there is a lot of discussion about...
Which is your favorite thing.
It's one of my favorite things. There's a whole discussion about whether evidentiality is its own category separate from mode or if it sits within like a more lumper definition of mode or whether we split it off as its own or if it sits in a subcategory. It reminds me a lot about how I imagine the early discussions around like biological classification must have happened.
Yeah, because at a certain point, you're like, okay, so we need to have all of these different sorts of levels of, like, are these just different species of birds, or are they all birds together? Are they, you know, here we've got the mammals, here we've got... I'm not a biologist, I'm not going to torture this metaphor too far. but, you know, which of the things are sort of more closely related, which of the things are more distantly related? And there's seven levels here, but some of them you're like, well, you just needed to come up with another name for this.
Yeah.
And... it's useful to have a name as a sort of handle for, so that we're all talking about the same thing. But sometimes these names don't always have like a very good etymological reason for why they're called that thing in particular. And sometimes it's just like, well, we need a name for this group.
And sometimes a level like, because there are classes in biological animal kingdom hierarchies, right? Mm-hmm. And so the word class there has like a really specific meaning. Whereas we could just talk about like... a general class of objects or, you know, a particular class of students. Like it has all these different meanings. And I think mode is one of those similar words that has lots of different meanings, but in linguistics tends to have this specific meaning.
Yeah. And this is a thing that, you know, academic disciplines, especially in the sort of like natural philosophy vibe of categorizing the world and trying to figure out which things are more related to each other, tends to kind of go into common words and say, we're going to come up with a technical definition for this one. and be like, well, technically, this is what a reptile is now. Like, technically, this is what a mood is now. This is what a mode is. And you end up with a situation where the sort of technical definitions and the vernacular definitions coexist. And that can sometimes lead to almost more confusion where you're like, I need to figure out, first of all, is this person using the technical meaning right now? Or are they using the vernacular meaning? Which one am I trying to use? Which one is appropriate for this context? In addition to sort of what is this word? Whereas sometimes if there's an entirely new word for something, it's just like, oh, well, I've learned this new word and it refers to this specific thing and it always refers to that. There isn't this sort of competing vernacular definition that also exists. And the way that this often gets taught in classrooms is like, well, the vernacular version you learned is wrong and this is the real definition. But I think, you know, we're interested in describing language and saying, like, you know, descriptively, people use mode in all sorts of different ways. People use mood in all sorts of different ways. It's just that in certain contexts, there's this one very particular definition that it's used with, you know, in this one case. Oh, case, that's another one. Look, you can use case. You can use case to mean a whole lot of things. There is one technical linguistic meaning of it, but there's also a lot of other ways you can use case. And sometimes the metaphor goes in the other direction. Sometimes a word gets borrowed from grammatical terminology into the sort of more generic, you know, life circumstances as well. You know, gender initially refers to just a class, like a genre. And then it gets sort of used in a vernacular sense as well.
I have a sense that imperative, if something is very important, it's imperative, came from the urgency of a command as well.
Mm. Yeah, it's possible. Like the idea of like, okay, well, this is this particular grammatical thing, but also can kind of get used metaphorically for the whole related set of ideas.
In much the same way that the Linnaean biological classification system owes a lot to Latin terminology and that kind of Western tradition of classification, I can't help but feel that part of the reason we have a category of imperatives is because, as you mentioned earlier, Latin happens to have a very clear imperative form of the verb. And I wonder what would have happened to a grammatical tradition and how we classify modality and mode and imperatives if we started with a language that didn't have those structures.
Yeah, I think it's a difficult to answer question, but it's a really valid question. Like, I found Latin has this sort of reputation of like, oh, I didn't understand grammar until I studied Latin. And that's not because other languages like don't have grammar. It's because a lot of our grammatical terminology was invented specifically for Latin and to work really well for Latin. And then you end up learning about how English grammar works because you learn Latin in a very translate-y sort of way, and you learn sort of what the reflexes are of particular Englishy things in Latin or of things in another language in Latin. And so it feels like Latin grammar is easier because the grammar as we learn it was invented to fit Latin really well.
As someone who didn't study Latin, I'm very happy to say that I didn't understand English grammar until I studied linguistics. And it achieves similar ends, but from a very different perspective.
Yeah, and I think having studied both Latin and linguistics, there's a sense in which the grammar of Latin is very catalogued in many cases. It's very pinned down because it's not a language that's actively being spoken by people. So it has sort of been finitely described. And the thing that excites me about linguistics is you can approach grammar in this more experimental way, where you can say things like, is the imperative really valid in this language? Or, you know, does this language have a prohibitive? Is this a useful categorization to make? Is this a useful distinction to make? And that's something that's less the case when you're talking about one very well-described language, and something that's more the case when you're trying to figure out, okay, how do languages compare with each other? Or what's going on in language in general? Or what else is going on here? Or what's going on in a language that isn't as well-described? It's a sort of more expansive look at how grammar can work than just like, okay, here's a list of all the stuff you learn. You can be trying to figure out what's going on with grammar.
And one of the joys of the imperative, as we said, it's really relatively uncomplex grammatically across a lot of different languages. And then it's so interactively complicated and fascinating. And that's, I think, what keeps bringing you back to this kind of category.
Yeah, which makes it a good introduction to the idea of, okay, how could we sort of do these categories? What does it mean for a verb to have a mood or a mode? And, you know, where something like the subjunctive, which is another mood, is harder to wrap your head around. And so if you're trying to get a handle on both of those things at the same time, it can be overwhelming. Whereas the imperative is a good sort of slice to break off of, here's this thing that we know how to do the command thing. You know, someone wrote a YA novel about it in 1997. but also it's a sort of gateway into considering this broader question of like, yeah, what sort of vibes can the verbs have? For more Lingthusiasm and links to all the things mentioned in this episode, go to lingthusiasm.com. You can listen to us on Apple Podcasts, Google Podcasts, Spotify, SoundCloud, YouTube, or wherever else you get your podcasts. And you can follow at Lingthusiasm on Twitter, Facebook, Instagram, and Tumblr. You can get IPA scarves, IPA greeting cards, and other Lingthusiasm merch at lingthusiasm.com/merch. I can be found as at Gretchen A. McC on Twitter. My blog is allthingslinguistic.com, and my book about internet language is called Because Internet.
I tweet and blog as Superlinguo. Have you listened to all the Lingthusiasm episodes and you wish there were more? You can get access to 48 bonus episodes to listen to right now at patreon.com/lingthusiasm or follow the links from our website. Patrons also get access to our Discord chat room to talk with other linguistics fans and other rewards, including an upcoming live show, and they also help keep the show ad-free. Recent bonus topics include deleted anecdotes, an Ask Me Anything with a lexicographer, and a Q&A with the two of us. If you can't afford to pledge, that's okay too. We really appreciate it if you can recommend Lingthusiasm to anyone who needs a little more linguistics in their lives.
Lingthusiasm is created and produced by Gretchen McCulloch and Lauren Gawne. Our senior producer is Claire Gawne, our editorial producer is Sarah Dopirala, and our music is Ancient Cities by The Triangles.
Stay Lingthusiastic.